Please be seated. Now I don't have a book, you can safely keep it. Did it record or no?
Yes, it did.
Did? Good. And you? Where is he?
He's coming.
Did your recorder record or it was covered by the book?
I think it recorded.
Good. You need not bother Maharaj, I howl and shout. Dear friends, now we are in a very relaxed mood and we are here today now to share with you some of my very interesting interaction with Srimati Swami Virajananda Ji Maharaj, who was gracious enough, kind and compassionate enough to accept me as his disciple and thereafter to allow me to be his personal attendant Shivak, as we are, as it is used in our language, attendance for all practical purposes. And I must tell you the danger of repetition of these incidents. The danger is, it is an interaction between him and me. So I have to use my presence to explain to you what his reaction was. So I always come in the picture. And that is a cause of being a bit swollen-headed. So, if I have to say what I said or what I did, please bear in mind, I do so to highlight what he said and how he reacted. This is one aspect. And the other aspect is that it was nearly 63 years ago when I was 23 years old. And I was in the organization only for 18 months. With that capacity and that background, I used to try and understand and evaluate his personality. So you can very well understand how incompetent I was to assess such a mighty, noble personality, which now, after 64 years, I try and understand, oh dear me, what was he and how I treated with him, how I behaved with him. And I really feel very, very, very small of myself. Anyway, so please, while describing his reactions, I have to tell you what I did or what I said. Kindly excuse me if I overstepped the limit. Anyway, my first interaction with him. I came to know Swami Shantaswarupananda Ji, who spent 25 years of his life here in San Francisco as an associate of Ashokananda Ji, because Ashokanandaji chose him. Why? Because Shanta Swarupanandaji was a student of Ashokananda when he was in the school. And that relationship and that mutual confidence over each other was one of the reasons why Ashokanandaji chose out of so many Swami Shanta Swarupanandaji to come here and assist him. That is how Shanta Swarupananda and Ashokanandaji had a link together. Now, before coming to San Francisco in the year 1948, Shanta Swarupanandaji was the manager of the establishment of Advaita Ashram in Calcutta City. And that was our publishing center, and the books were all sold from there and to the retailers and wholesalers. To cut a long story short, I went to him, to his place, Advaita Ashram, to buy a particular book. And that is how I saw him face to face. And that is how he slowly and slowly won me over with his affectionate care and understanding. And here where I am is because of him. That is the starting point. In the year 1946, Virajanandaji returned to Belur Math after his tour and stay in other places in the country there. Mostly he used to spend his spare time in Shamlatal, the ashram that he has left behind. So it was in the month of September 1946 when, with my interaction with Shanta Swarupanandaji increasing, he one day told me when I visited him, "Look, my dear child, our President Maharaj, Swami Virajanandaji, is arriving at Belur Math tomorrow, and it is our tradition that all of us, as early as possible, without disturbing him, we should go and meet him and seek his blessings and offer our pranams. So I'll have to go day after tomorrow. Will you come along?" Now don't start laughing. I said, "Swami, you are good enough for me. Any higher category doesn't appeal to me." He looked at me. That person became stern. Those of you who know what Shanta Swarupanandaji was, he was the epitome of the meaning of his name. Shanta Swarup, ever cool. "Why do you talk like a stupid ass?" "Don't you know who he is?" Then I thought, probably really I have given my views very unjustifiably. I said, "No, Maharaj, I don't know." And he said, "He is Swamiji's sannyasi disciple, the first of the four, and he is Holy Mother's disciple, and he is the first person after Guru Maharaj's children, the direct disciples, to join that holy company when they were in full blast of their austerity in Varanagar Math. And you told me, tell me that you are not interested in high category of Swami. Why do you talk like a stupid ass?" I kept quiet. I said, "When have I to come to you? I won't go up myself. I'll be with you. You take me along." "Yes, yes, that's what I mean. I will introduce you to him. That's why I'm asking you." This is how it started. So now the first interview, let us explain. Enjoy that moment again. In those days, Belur Mutt was not such a popular, crowded place. On a weekday at about 4:30 in the evening, when Virajananda used to sit for public darshan, hardly 15 or 20 people used to come. And after that, there were Swamis. They used to come from close by distance to seek his blessings. His personality was something I can't describe to you. It's so sweet, at the same time, so indrawn. By the look at his face, you could feel he lives in a different world. He doesn't belong to this world. But when you interact with him, he's as alert as ever. Much more alert than we are. That was how he was. Anyway, so there was not much of a crowd. What to speak of much of a crowd? When Parvati Maharaj Shanti Swarupananda, you took me along, it was about 4:30. He was sitting in his armchair with his legs spread, because he was an old man, couldn't bend his legs, on an inclined footstool, and he was there, and he was puffing away at his hookah, and he was in his own mood. So Parvati Maharaj went, I followed him. This is my first exposure in life after Parvati Maharaj, a Swami of such a caliber of standing. And then he was very kind, Parvati Maharaj, Shanti Swarupanandji, Parvati, how are you? How is everything with Advaita Ashram? How are the sale proceeds going? Are people slowly and slowly accepting Swamiji's ideas? I was standing aside, seeing. When he was asking these questions, Parvati Maharaj, let me call him by that name, that was his common name, Parvati. Parvati Maharaj fell flat on his face, from a distance touched his feet, and slowly, yes Maharaj, yes Maharaj, yes Maharaj, in Bengali, language was Bengali, and he was hushing. And Parvati Maharaj started looking at me. I, as usual, like a stupid ass, I was standing erect like a stick, and I was doing namaskaram like this. And Parvati was looking at me like, saying, don't you see how I did it? So, in my lifetime, I've never done that. So I managed my trouser and its crease. And with my bush shirt, I made an awful, laughable, awkward scene. Somehow or other, I could do that. And from the corner of my eyes, I was thinking, this venerable old man must be very annoyed and cross and angry with him. And I saw there was a picture of amusement in his face. He was amused to see my awkwardness. And then Parvati Maharaj slowly asked about his welfare and etc., as it is common protocol. And then he started introducing me to him. Maharaj, this boy is a young boy, this is his name, he comes from such and such a family, and etc. And he, that was my first experience, what a spiritual personality is like. He was constantly nodding his head, listening to him, and he was gazing at me from my head to my toe. And I really felt, oh my, what penetrative eyes. He's knowing me through and through, seeing me through and through. And once, twice, thrice. But the fun of it is, I in return felt, please, you see me through and through. I feel very safe with you. I don't have to pose before you. I don't have to appear before you what I am not. Here I am, standing in your presence. Please see me, study me, understand me through and through. Instead of being afraid of that penetrative look, I felt so comforted that here is a man to whom I need not try to explain who am I or what am I. He is seeing me through and through. He is reading every line of the book. And then, all of a sudden, he remembers my grandfather's name, and out of the blue he asks me, do you know such and such a person? And that was a shock of my life. Oh my, what a person. He knows my grandfather, my grandfather's elder brother. I said, yes, Maharaj. He happens to be my grandfather's, means father's, father's elder brother, paternal grandfather. Yes, Maharaj, he happens to be the elder brother of my... Ha! That is why you are here. I couldn't make any head and tail out of it. That is why you are here. But what can I do? I could keep quiet. And then after a while, with exchanging a few pleasantries, Parvati Maharaj again fell flat on his face, touched his feet, and took leave of him. This time, the second time, I was a bit smarter. I know how to go about it. And then, as is our vogue, Parvati Maharaj slowly and slowly withdraw. You can't turn your back on them, you know. You don't turn your back on God. So you always withdraw facing him and take leave of him from the door. Parvati Maharaj slowly and slowly walked out and bowed down again, left the door. It was my turn. I also imitated Parvati Maharaj. And when I bowed down and I closed the door, I distinctly heard, absolutely as clear as daylight, in a manner that he is speaking to himself, as it were. It is not meant for me, as it were. He said in Bengali, I'm translating it for you, Swamiji wanted such young boys. It entered my ears all right. Swamiji wanted such young boys. Swamiji amon chelei chaiten. I heard, as an old man, he's in his own mood, he sings, bowed down, closed the door. I didn't share this with Parvati Maharaj. Parvati Maharaj only told me, next time when you come to me, come wear your dhotis and your shirt, not your trousers and bush shirt. That's all. And I was a little, I would say, concerned. What does this old man mean? But I kept it to myself. I didn't speak it to Parvati Maharaj that day. After a few months, he always, Virajananda always, wherever he could be, he would come back to Belur Math before the Durga Pujas, and he would leave after Guru Maharaj's annual function, the public celebration. After that, after a week or so, he used to go out again. Now, a few days later, after the Durga Puja, before the Diwali, before Guru Maharaj's birthday, a period between Swamiji's birthday and Guru Maharaj's birthday is generally 5 weeks during that. Parvati Maharaj once said, Shalil, if you are serious enough, then it is better you be initiated. Again, I made the same mistake and I told him, Maharaj, I'm quite happy under your care and your guidance and training. I'm quite happy, Maharaj. Why again bring somebody else whom I'll not see, will not meet, with whom I cannot interact? I'm quite happy with you. Again, he scolded me. Don't talk and give your opinion in matters which is beyond you, which you do not understand. Do you understand me? I said, yes, Maharaj, I do. So now, how things happen? He said, come that day along with me, I'll take you to Maharaj, and I will personally request him to initiate you, to accept you as his disciple, and you only decently and carefully do pranam as I do. Good enough. So I went there, and all that I was tutored, I behaved properly and correctly this time, and then Parvati Maharaj, on my behalf, told him, sir, this young boy who came with me the other day to seek your blessings, he doesn't have the courage to say so, but he would like to be initiated by you. Sir, I can tell you, he's prepared for this. He listened, looked at me, said, all right, look at me. And then he said, if you are recommending Parvati, I have no heart to say no, but I do not know what the position is like. The position means he was not very much mobile at that time. He used to be in his room, and maximum number of persons, both men and women, boys and girls, young boys and girls, 25 of them could be squeezed into his bedroom and arranged in such a manner that he used to sit there, like this Guru Maharaj, Maan and Swamiji's pictures would be arranged, he would sit, and 25 of us could sit there. That was the optimum. So the position is, which day there is less than 25 where I could be accommodated. So he told me to go to the Swami, who was his secretary, and have a word with him. I went to him, I was told he lives just below downstairs, go and talk to him and all that. I went and I told him, Maharaj, Virajananda ji has sent me to you to ask for a date when it would be possible for me to be initiated. That was the first time I met that Swami. He looks at me like this. You went to him directly? Yes, Maharaj, Parvati Maharaj took me along with him. So I did go to him directly and he asked me to tell you, it's not possible 10,000 people are on the waiting list. And every day that he is initiating and he is in Belur Math, all the days are full. You'll have to wait your turn. Do you understand? Yes, Maharaj, I do. Slowly it came up. As soon as I came up, Parvati Maharaj asked me, what is it? So I told him in a whispering manner, this is what it is. What do I tell him? He said, you keep quiet. So he tells Virajanandaji, Maharaj, all the days that you are initiating, your room is full, so this boy has to wait. Oh, is that so? So he had a habit of nodding and shaking his head. It looked wonderful with his beard and his flowing hair. It looked just wonderful. Oh, is that so? Parvati, you better go and tell him I want to see him now. He didn't send me again. He said, oh Parvati, you better go and tell him that I want to see him now. Before Parvati Maharaj could make a move, this was in typical colloquial Bengali. I'm trying to maintain the flavor as much as is possible, but in English language. You see, Parvati, this chappy, excuse my language, I'm being very honest, this chappy is so lean and thin and tall, his bottom is as big as a small earthen pot. I find every time I sit for initiation, there's a little space between my footstool and where the implements are kept. Can't he squeeze his little bottom down there? And I'm told, and you must be surprised, he was supposed to be a spiritual giant. And that was his flavor. That was the excellence of his life, which I learned to see and appreciate for the 3 years of my life when I was his shevak. I'll come to that slowly. Be prepared to go to bed a little late. So, that is the comment he made. Parvati Maharaj, with due decorum, just had a smile and said nothing. He goes and calls him up, the secretary. He calls him by name. I'm told it is so heavily booked that this boy cannot be accommodated. Yes, sir, it's all totally booked and I have no information of any rejection so that there may be a space available. So he has to wait. Yes, I think so. But Bimal, and he repeats the same word. But Bimal, on my right hand side, when I stretch my leg forward, I have seen a little empty space there. Look at this boy, he has a very small body. Put him in there this Wednesday, day after tomorrow. Put him in there next Wednesday, day after tomorrow. It is Guru Maharaj's birthday. Can't you squeeze in there? He looks at me. And without creating any bad blood, without creating any, in a jocular, homely manner, he got it done. And just told me, go and ask him, Parvati, you better help him. It seems he's very raw. Parvati, you better help him to tell him what are the ingredients and etc., etc., that he has to. Parvati Maharaj understood the suggestion. We took leave of him. And that day, 21st of February 1947, I was initiated. Later on, I thought, and even today I think, if he had not been so kind and compassionate, probably I would have waited I don't know how long, and whether I would ever had initiations or not, I never knew. But he made up his mind. I was a very shy person at that time. I think I am yet today, but people don't believe me. Of those 26 persons, his procedure was the general instructions were given to all of us together. General instructions as far as process of japam, process of meditating, and this and etc., etc. And he had a printed booklet which he made one of us stand up and read loudly and get it cleared by all the others that they have understood. If not, we had the right to ask him a clarifying question. And it took quite some time. And after that, each one of us was asked to go out of the room, stand in this veranda in front of Swamiji's bedroom, and one by one, they were called in. He used to utter the mantra to them, get it repeated, and all those personal instructions, which has to be on one-to-one basis, was imparted then. And the initiated disciple offered all that he had to offer as Ishta Pranami and as Guru Dakshina, two set of offerings. All that was done, and then it was his custom that it took quite some time, 25 of them given individual time. We started at about 9 o'clock in the morning, and when we went for our prasad, it was about 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And he used to wait. When words used to go to him that all of us are seated for our prasad, 25 of us, 26 of us, he, that was the only day it was 26. Anyway, what he did was, he created, from Guru Maharaj's prasad, he created Guru Prasad, and he personally came all the way from his room to the dining hall to give us prasad all by himself and walk down and bless everybody. That was the end of his duties, and he retired. And we, after our meals, we went back home. That procedure was over, and I was absolutely in cloud nine. After a while, in month of November, that is a long story, I need not repeat it, I left home and joined the order at Advaita Ashram under Parvati Maharaj's care. Parvati Maharaj warned me that he has been selected to be posted to San Francisco. The date has been decided. If I want an easy transition in my life to happen, it is better I come when he is here and he will help me to find my feet in this organization. It's quite rational, Krishna. So it so happened that I came and joined, and etc., etc. In the meantime, my mother, that very year, seeing, I don't know, as mothers look after their children, she could fathom a transformation in my personality. And she used to tell me, "What has happened to you? you are not so boisterous, you are not so extrovert, you are always thinking of something, what has happened to you? I would like to meet your guru. Could you organize it? I would like to meet your guru. Good enough? So the fact of life is, my mother, when she saw him, she fell for it and she wanted to be initiated. And she introduced herself as my mother. What an introduction! And immediately Virajanandaji removed all obstacles, these technicalities, initiated. I think he did it on purpose. He had some ideas probably. Anyway, when I joined the order, he was away from Belur, but he was in Dehradun. Parvati Maharaj asked me to write a letter informing him that you have left earth and home, you have joined the order, and seek his blessings as your guru, so that your life may be in his own hand, which was a bit full of tremor. He writes back a beautiful letter, very small, but the content is very, very huge. The ideology that has forced you to take such a decision, denying your parents the right of services from you, remember, you must be honest to that commitment, and that will be an ample reward for your grieving parents. Live up to the commitments which has forced you to deny your parents your services to them. And more you live according to that principle, that will be the best way of serving them. That's all. And God bless you, and etc., etc. Next step is, somehow or other, after Parvati Maharaj left again, that was coincidence, 21st of February 1948, he left for the States. I really felt orphaned because of my shy nature. I did not make many friends to have a shoulder to weep upon. You understand me? I was all by myself, and I could not adjust myself in that atmosphere where it was saturated by Parvati Maharaj's presence, and I missed him all of a sudden, and I really was unable to adjust myself. The senior monks could understand the situation, and they transferred me from Advaita Ashrama, Calcutta, to Benares, where Shantanandaji used to live. And I had known him as a student. Parvati Maharaj had introduced me to him when he visited Belur Math. Now, Shantanandaji was one of our very, very senior monks, senior to Madhavanandaji. He and two of his class fellows, three of them walked from their village, their home, to Jaramati to be initiated by the Divine Mother. 1905. So he was in his own right a very, very advanced soul. Unfortunately, he developed some illness, and as I was a readily available human material in Benares without any commitment, they put me onto that job. So that's a long story, different story. What I want to say is, he taught me how to live with Swamis. That was the first thing he did. He understood where the way of maladjustment had started. My loneliness, unable to interact with people. and he taught me how to live in this community. And it so happened that he had to be transferred to an hospital. I had to be relieved from him. In the meantime, without my knowledge, I never knew a bit of it, Virajananda ji was tracking me as to where I am, what am I doing, and etc., etc., etc. He was mighty pleased, that is what I come to know from the present-day president, Atmasthananda ji. He was also with him for a pretty long time. He told me that, look, he has been watching you as to what are you doing, where are you are, and he's mighty happy that you have served Shantanandi. He's extremely pleased with you, but he never expresses himself. So Shantanandaji had to come back to Belurmat. From there he was sent to the hospital, and I was relieved of that responsibility of serving him. Before he went to the hospital, which Virajanandaji organized, Virajanandaji came to meet Shantanandaji in his room because Shantanandaji was bedridden. That was a sight for the gods to see. Virajanandaji, very elderly person, quite heavily built, with his stick on, slowly and slowly and slowly, arrives in his room. It was a small room, 8 feet by 8 feet. Half of it was occupied by his bed. It was a little place left where I put his chair, and I stood away at the farthest corner, knowing him what he is. Shantanandaji was extremely, I would say, praiseful of me. Started praising me about my dedication, about my attentive care, about my affection. And I could see that Virajanandaji is swelling in pride. Absolutely. Like a proud father, he's swelling in pride. And occasionally, as I told you, he had a charming way of shaking his head. Occasionally he was saying, "Don't worry, Khogan, don't worry. That chap is extremely fortunate to serve a Swami like you. You don't worry." And he was feeling proud. I kept quiet and I was feeling embarrassed. Why should Shantanandaji say so? He goes back to his room, and I was having a real with Swamiji. "Maharaj, you shouldn't have said that. What does he think? Probably he thought I'm making you plead for me and all that. No, you shouldn't have said." All bully-headed ideas imposed on him. And he was so innocent and childlike. He said, "Do you think I was wrong?" I say, "I think, Maharaj, you have overdone it." Then he'll keep quiet and say, "No, my mother says I've done it right. I'm not going to listen to you." I've seen him doing so all through these 6 months that I was with him. I was saying, "Maharaj, this is not right, not proper." Like an indolent child, you know, absolutely indulgent. And he said, "You think so? I'm wrong." Well, wait. "No, my mother says I'm right. I'm not going to listen to you." That is, he said the same thing then. And then, after a while, Virajanandaji's attendant comes running to me and tells me, "Virajanandaji wants you to meet him at 2 o'clock sharp in his room. Make sure you're not late by a minute. Then that's the end of it." I said, "All right." And I was scared. Why does Virajanandaji of all persons want to see me? It must be an impression that he had had with this interaction with Shantananda, and I'm to be scolded. That's so much of praise and this and this and this. I was concerned And again Shantanandaji says, why are you concerned? I said, Maharaj, I may be scolded, I may be rebuked, this and this and this. I don't know what the impression he carried after your talk with you, but he has sent for me. And he said, no, my mother says it will be all right with you. Good enough. He knew and his mother knows. I don't know anything. At 2 o'clock, couple of minutes before two, I was scared to death. I was standing outside the door. Just at the strike of two, the half of the door opened and I was asked to come in by the Shivak, the then Shivak. So I was trembling in my bones. I walked in and kept the farthest distance from him, from where he was seated. From there, without touching him, going near him, I did my Shashtanga pranams more smartly than the first time. And when I knelt up and I was with my folded hands looking at him, he says very sweetly, why are you so far away from me? Come closer. So I crawled a couple of inches. Oh, no, no, come closer, come closer. Till I reached his knees. He was again sitting with his legs on a slopey footstool. And then he looks at me and tells me, when Khagen was praising you and admiring your services, I felt so proud of myself that when I told you Swamiji wanted such children, such boys, I was right. Come close, my dear. Now, during service of Shantanandaji, there were certain controversial matters, and I had to face several criticisms. Because of that, I had a feeling, an apprehension, that he may be in the know of it, and probably he may ask me to leave the organization. That was my apprehension. When I heard him saying that when Khagen was praising you and admiring your services, I felt so proud of you, my child. I thought I haven't made a mistake. And he repeated those words which I heard a couple of years ago. And because of that conflicting emotions, I burst into tears. And spontaneously I could tell him only this within my sobs, in between my sobs, sir, you are my guru. Because of your grace, it was all possible. I don't come in the picture at all. It is your grace, sir. And I wept and wept and wept on his thighs. His dhoti was wet. And he was so surprised. He, in his own defense, he tells me, hey, my dear child, I am praising you. I am approving you. Why are you weeping? I am feeling so awkward. He tells me, I am praising you, I am admiring you, appreciating you. Why are you weeping? You make me feel awkward. So somehow or other, I collected myself. Says, since I came back from Shantananda's room, I was thinking you deserve a prize. I was thinking, what prize can I give you? I have found out a prize for you. from tomorrow onwards, you will be my Shivak. That is your price. It was something from the skies, as it were, but look at my stupidity. I became absolutely alert. Sir? No, sir, no. I don't need this prize. He looks at me. That what is it that he is denying? And I, like, as you know, as a stupid idiot ass, I said, sir, I am told you are a stern disciplinarian. You are an exacting taskmaster. You are, sir, very short-tempered. There are many Swamis and Brahmacharis who came to serve you and they were shown the door. Now, sir, if Ishta is annoyed with you, Guru helps you. If Guru is annoyed with you, you're destroyed. I lectured him. And the patience of that person, he enjoyed every word of it. And now I think, if he had been actually so, he would have asked me to turn, and a kick in the bottom, I would have flown out of the window. But nothing doing, he was very amazed and amused. Oh, is that so? Is that so? And then he thinks for a while. And then he asks me, hey, how long have you joined this organization? To such a person, with my pride, I say 18 months. Why? I'm here for 18 months? And he, in the same tone, repeats, it is amazing. In 18 months' time, you have read my horoscope thoroughly. Oh, in 18 months' time, you have read my horoscope thoroughly. I'm quiet now. Just waiting for something else. Now, let me see. It is not comfortable to die with such false allegations. It is not, I am an old man, it is not comfortable to die with such false allegations. Could you kindly give me a chance and live with me and see what type of man I am? He has made up his mind, he will not let me go. And I was trying to wriggle out of him. But I'm really, I feel amazed today. My. What a word antaryami means. He was looking at my heart, not my words. That is what was happening. He was scanning me through and through. He never bothered what my words meant. And then he said, now look, my dear, it's my request. Give me a chance to prove to you I am not as bad as I am told to be. I had no escape. So I just kept quiet. Is it all right if we start from tomorrow morning? And now, that's not the limit of my stupidity. I went another step forward, and now I cannot believe myself that all that had happened with such a soul. You know what's that? I took now a stronger position. And I said, all right, sir, I will agree on one condition. And he says, as many conditions as you please. And I swear, my dears, it is verbatim and true. As many conditions as you please. I said, no, sir, I'm very practical about it. What's it? And I was very, very talking like a wise man. No, sir, I'm very practical about it. What's it? I said, for the first 15 days, sir, I will not be guided by the senior brahmacharis and shevaks. It is you who will tell me from morning till night for next 15 days what are your likes, what are your dislikes. And you will not make me nervous by scolding these 15 days. You will not scold me for these 15 days. I'll get nervous. From the 16th day, if I make any mistake, kick me out. Oh, is that so? He says. And then after a while, he pushes a hand forward. It's a fair deal. And that was my appointment. And then literally, from next morning, those 15 days, he was so alert when I was around, how I am walking, how I am talking, how I am behaving, and my duty as an initiator was, I have to sweep his floor every day, morning and evening, mop his floor every day, morning and evening, wash his clothes. We did not have those electric iron and presses and all that. We had to do it with our own hands and keep it below his pillow so that the head pressure on the pillow presses it. And every bit of it to the minute detail, it did not escape his observation. I'll give you an example. I was mopping. Oh, who has mopped at home, my dearest 22-year-old boy? You are kept away from it. So you have to do it now. So I was sitting on my feet and then holding the mop and the bundle in my hand. He sees. And occasionally what I used to do was, while working, I used to look at him to find out whether there's a look of approval or disapproval. That's how it went on. It was a battle of wits between the two. And he used to nod his head, disapproval. How do I go about it? You come here. Bring the bucket. Bring the mopper. Bring the mop. And he told me how to wash it, how to keep it semi-moist, how to hold it that in one sweep I cover a bigger amount of space, less work for me. Every bit of it he used to tell. And it was very difficult to get a nod of assent. As for instance, I have mopped to the best of my ability the way he has said, and I looked at him and I asked him, where have I gone wrong, Maharaj? All that you have done is pushed all the dirt in the groove of the floor. In Bengal, in ancient days, when cement was first brought into use, cement used to develop drying cracks. When it dried up, it developed a crack. To avoid that, a disfigurement of the floor, people with their ingenuity decided small little coir ropes, when the cement was raw, was pressed on the floor into several decorations. And if there was a contraction crack, a drying up crack, it happened in that area, which is weaker. So the cracks were there, happened, but they were concealed by that depression on the floor. So I moved my hand like that, across that line. He says, all that you have done is push the dirt into that crack. You have pushed the dirt into that deep line. So how do I clean it? Come here, I'll teach you. I go with that dirty bucket and that mop. And you know, he takes a corner of that mop, wraps it up like a piece of reed log, dips it, makes it semi liquid, and then tells me, now go, hold it on the end of the line, press it with your finger and bring it back. There was a practical application of doing your work perfectly. So I cannot recount to you at every step how to walk, how to behave yourself, how to put on your clothes, how to mop the floor, sweep the floor, how to serve him a glass of water. You know, I never knew that before, I don't know, you may be knowing. I used to hold the glass as it is and hand it over to him. He would not approve of that. Where is the space for me to hold the glass? And then I thought, really, I'm holding it, I've left no space for him. So he said, bring the glass to me. And then he puts his little finger across. Put the glass on my little finger, yes, and hold it by your other three fingers at the bottom part so that the top part is available to me to hold. That is how Swamiji taught me to hold a glass of water. So you must have enormous amount of patience to live with that person who is an exacting taskmaster. When I grew a little old with him, I was with him for about 3 years and a few months. I asked him one day, sir, isn't it carrying it too far? I started taking a bit liberties with him. By the time he was also responding in life, if you start practicing doing something regularly and correctly, you are developing a habit. And this habit in due course of time will create such a force in you, you cannot do in spite of yourself anything imperfect. The habit has made a slave of you to be perfectionist. Now, I start here, you end up when you meditate. He says, I start here, you end up when you meditate, you will be able to meditate perfectly without allowing your mind to go waywards. Now what do you think of it? Each and every aspect of life was under his scrutiny. And he was a pursuer of perfection and pursuer of excellence, and he insisted. I'll end up with another story, an enjoyable story. Incident, not a story. Story has a pinch of imagination. It's an incident. He, wherever he sat and whenever he lied down in his bed, he had one side table with him all the time. Side table had several items of things to be kept there. He willingly did not have a rectangular table because then we will be able to find out the coordinates and keep the things in its right place every time. He had to have a circular table. So there are no coordinates. And on that table, he had his magnifying glass, he had his a pouch of matchsticks, he has his cigarettes, his ashtray, his call bell, and something else. Seven or eight items had to be arranged on that round table. His chair had a fixed place. This round table, his side table, must be in a fixed place. And these items will not move out of the designated places. And what he used to do is reading the newspaper. He wants the magnifying glass. He will not look there. He will keep on looking at the paper. His hand used to move like a robot, measured. And he takes his hand there where the handle of the magnifying glass is supposed to be. And he goes there, instead of the gap between the thumb and the index finger, the handle is hitting his index finger. That is enough. Like the world on fire, he keep on ringing the bell. And we were round about, I came running helter-skelter, sir, what's happened? He sits like that. And while talking to me, his arm moves thrice. And he says, where have you kept my magnifying glass? I don't find it. It's miles away. So all that I had to do was move the handle of that handle of the magnifying glass 1 millimeter or 1.5 millimeter. That was enough. It is miles away. And he will not look, he's feeling, he will not pick it up, he will rather spend his energy on the Coleman, as if the world is on fire. And we have to do and correct it. That was his exactitude. Then I used to tell him, sir, you are a wonderful person. I really, later on, started behaving with him like my grandfather. I served him well, I attained that level of perfection which he wanted, and I was very dear to him for that purpose. He used to openly say so, but I used to take liberties with him like that. I said, sir, you are a wonderful person. Why, what's wrong? That's how he used to start. Sir, the minimum concept of space is 1 mile, and your minimum concept of time is 1 hour. Why? He will have his cup of tea, and he would not like anybody standing on him to take the empty cup. I must keep busy. Time is not for wasting. Waiting for him to finish is not permissible. Go and get to some useful work. Come on time. What is the time? He used to put the cup on the saucer. It was porcelain, you know, with a click noise. And he knew I could be there and he allowed me that time to come. If I'm a second late, where were you? I'm holding this saucer for an hour. And I used to say, sir, you are a wonderful person. Your minimum concept of time is an hour, and minimum concept of space is a mile. And you know, he used to smile, never reacted. That is how I started serving him. And ultimately, what happened was, please don't misunderstand me. What happened was, it was like a battle of wits with him. He raises his level of perfection, level of expectation, and I try hard to grow up to that level. And a time came when, before he had an occasion to look at me for a thing, it was there. I was so tuned with his mind, I knew in advance what he could ask and what. And I'll give you an example. And what a wonderful relationship it was. You know, he used to have his dinner on his own dining table, a small little one, a little bigger than this. And I used to stand behind him. He didn't allow anybody to stand in front to see he's eating. I used to stand behind him. As soon as he finished his meal, I had to place a washing bowl in front of him, finger bowl, and he used to wash himself. And having washed his hand and with a little water, he used to wash his lips. The moustaches got moist, the beard got moist, but he used to do that and wash the adjoining hairs. And as soon as that is done, he'll squeeze the last drop of water from his hand and put both hands on both sides. The left hand is meant for the hookah and the right hand is meant for the towel. And if there's little late, he would say, "Oh, my hands are tired. You have kept me waiting for an hour." That's his minimum concept of time. Anyway, I was wondering how I can reach both those extended hands at one go. It's beyond my reach. Thinking. And it struck me. What I did was, I kept that pipe of the hookah in my left hand, standing behind him, and the towel in my right hand, standing behind him. As soon as he raised his hand, I used to tap the hookah, the mouthpiece, on his hand. "I am ready. Why are you keeping me waiting?" Both the hands, from behind it is just the same distance, so the length of the hookah was not, pipe was my advantage. "Sir, I'm waiting. When will you take it?" Similarly, the towel was dangling. "Sir, I'm waiting. When will you take it?" And one day, the first day, he just withdrew his hand. And gave me a broad smile. That was the end of this competition. After that, he was accepting all that I did with good grace. He never had. Rather, in the latter days of his life, when the doctor used to come and it's time for injection, he would not agree. "Where is Shalil?" "Yes, sir." "Shalil, is it time for me, the injection? Are you sure? Have you checked up?" "Yes, sir." "All right. Then." And the doctors used to get annoyed. "Who is this chappie?" "That I am a doctor. I say it's time for the injection and you will ask him." I became the receiving end of some of the doctors. But what can be done? This is life. I'll end up with a moral education and then I will stop. It's getting late for you. It's already 17 past 9. In the evening hours, he used to sit for darshan. That is, he was available to the public indiscriminately, who came in a row, queue, did pronounce to him, offered him whatever he had to offer, and then they go out. It took about an hour or so every evening, 4 to 5 according to the season. He had a disciple. In those days he was an extremely rich person. He had several rice mills near Burdwan area, about 60 miles north of Calcutta. He used to often visit on weekends. And during this darshan period, he used to come and have his darshan, go back and join the line again, so that he had several times the blessings of his guru and darshan. And every time he came, he put a 500 rupee note at his feet. Every time. Virajananda ji was in his habit of saying, Jayastu Kalyanamastu, Jayastu Kalyanamastu. May victory be with you and may you have wealth. This is it. I was a young chap, as you know, as usual, standing behind his back and using a hand fan. Though the electric fan used to go, but he loved to be fanned by hand softly. And he liked the way I learnt it from my mother. So he appreciated, and that was my duty. I one day, wicked that I am, thought, why would he not bless him with such an amount of generosity? After all, he is paying him 500 rupees every time. I'll be honest with you. That is what my reaction. Let me see how he conducts himself with a poor person who cannot give him any money. Does he wish him jayastu kalyanamastu? And as good luck would have it, a very elderly widow, all stiffened up with arthritis and rheumatism, unable to move properly, all crooked up, as you know, it's a very common sight in India. A widow, doesn't seem to be affluent, came, took her time to bend down, could not bend down. Two senior shevaks were on both sides to protect Virajananda ji from any mishap, so they were getting impatient. Quickly, quickly, quickly. But she could not, somehow or other, she half inclined, made pranam, and then brought the pallu out and tried to unknot. There was some money in it, 2 annas, 1/8 of a rupee. A square little metal piece. And she was so slow, and as usual, because of her inability, the whole queue was getting impatient, and Swamis were also. I was looking at the whole situation from here. And now here's the time, let me see how he behaves. Who, my guru? How he behaves. I'm watching. And he, sitting there, no reaction, only when these two boys, his shevaks, wanted to physically remove that lady from the queue to set aside, he only said, no, don't touch, don't disturb. And then, in due course of time, lady could unknot it, a 2 anna coin, and I find Swami Virajananda ji bending forward to reach that lady, bending forward. Oh, mother, give me what you want to give me in Bengali. And she was full of joy. Virajananda ji, kalyanamastu, jayastu, kalyanamastu, and takes it, touches her head. that wicker basket on the side where money was kept, touches it. That was enough. And thereafter I find he's slowly turning towards me. Looking at me and giving me a sweet smile as if he has passed his exams. I think I'll stop here, otherwise it will dawn. Oh, every detail with him for 3 years. Endless joy and endless opportunity to make a man of yourself. But unworthy that we are nowhere there. Anyway. But he didn't spare himself. He gave his very best to build us up. So good night, dears. Good night. We meet tomorrow morning for our Gita class. Thank you.
Virajananda Maharaj used to go to Badanagar Ashram.
Pardon?
Virajananda Maharaj used to go to Badanagar Ashram, where Swamiji and his brother disciples used to stay in Badanagar.
I didn't hear that. I'm not old.
He's asking if Swami Virajananda went to Badanagar or Mutt.
Yeah, he was the first person to join the group. The order was not established then. Joined the group of direct disciples who were going through severe austere spiritual practices at Baranagar Mutt. He went there to join. Ramakrishnananda ji told him, "You are still a student. Is there any subject which is difficult for you?" He said, "Yes, mathematics is very difficult for me." He said, "During your vacation, you bring your books and notepapers for me, I will teach you." That was the first excuse when he went to stay and spend some time in Baranagar Mutt. That packet was never opened. He was learning other lessons. And then he left home and joined. But then there was no organization, you know. So he used to go and come back, go and come back. Once it so happened that he was struck by malaria and Mott had no means to provide him with diet. So all the Swamis together said, "Kali Krishna, you go back home. We can't feed you. You need good food and rest." He was so annoyed that he left the Mutt never to go back again. Sarat Maharaj, Swami Sridharanandaji, they developed a wonderful relationship in their later life. Sridharanandaji, all the way from Baranagar to where he was residing in the garden house of his father, it is nothing less than 12 miles away. And I don't know how Sarat Maharaj used to come to him frequently to cheer him up and not to have that idea not going back to the Mutt. And he did go back to the Mutt because Sarat Maharaj would not allow him to stay. Otherwise he might have not gone to the Mutt at all. Then later on, Belur Mutt was purchased and the mission was established and all that. And then he saw Swamiji for the first time. And in Swamiji's life, you must have read an incident where Swamiji was a young boy. He was very boisterous. We went to his friend's place and used to jump and climb up a magnolia tree, champak tree. And the head of the family used to scold Swamiji, "Don't do that. There is a ghost living there." In spite of being said so, all others stopped climbing, afraid of the ghost, but Swamiji kept on. So the old man said, "What are you doing, Naren?" He said, "I'm trying to find out what a ghost is like." That incident happened in Virajanandaji's ancestral house. Virajanandaji's uncle, Abhay Krishna, and Swamiji were class fellows. And that old man was Virajanandaji's grandfather. So that is a very beautiful incident. We'll read about the mother's teachings yesterday. Let me finish this. Please bear with me. It's a bit late. Time now. Anyway. Swami Virajanandaji had a standing regret deep within himself that when Sri Ramakrishna passed away, he was probably 14 years old. And when Virajanandaji was a boy, Sri Ramakrishna visited that area many, many, many a times, even in the common friend's house for talking and having satsang and all that. Many of his household had gone to see him. But Virajanandaji never saw Guru Maharaj in his physical form. So he had a standing in himself, a sense of guilt that I am so unfortunate. I had so many examples and opportunities. I have so many occasions and opportunities of seeing Sri Ramakrishna. I never had it. That was a deep-seated agony in him. Once he expressed this to the Holy Mother, after he was initiated, after the mott was established, after Mother used to come and stay at Nilambar Babu's garden house, which has now been acquired, and we call it the old monastery. Mother used to stay there outside the campus of the monastery. And Virajanandaji, being most young and Mother's disciple, he was asked to stand by the Holy Mother to meet her errands and demands. So one day, he goes to carry a message to the Holy Mother from Raja Maharaj. He stood at the door and Mother was facing this wall and doing some work, something holding. He stood there and Mother was in front of him, but Mother was facing the wall. She says, Mother, I have a deep abiding regret. What's it, my child? With all these occasions and opportunities, I never saw the Master. Mother did not reply. So he raised his voice, said again, Mother did not reply. Third time, with a little amount of indulgence, he said, Don't you listen to your son's agony? That having had all these opportunities, I did not see him. And Virajananda Swamiji tells me, that he finds Mother slowly and slowly moving on her feet, turned around, facing him with face covered by her veil. With her left hand, she threw it away, looked at Virajanandaji full blast. Why are you cursing yourself, my child? You are seeing him. Tumi to takei dekhcho. You are seeing him. And Virajanandaji says, Oh my, it was such a convincing sentence. He was nonplussed. He wouldn't understand the meaning of it. But he had delivered the message and went and took the ferry boat to go across. It was hand-rowed boat those days, real boats. And he was thinking, what does Mother mean? What does Mother mean? And immediately it struck him, did mother mean that seeing her and seeing Sri Ramakrishna in physical form is the same? And he looked towards that house where mother stayed, and to his utter surprise he finds mother standing at the veranda, raising her hands and telling him, like he's confirming him, yes, what you have thought is right. Seeing me is seeing the Divine Master. Well, please, let us stop now. Thank you for your patience. Shiva, 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 Shiva. That's it. Thank you.